Thank you very much, Asger, and thank you so much for inviting me here. Actually, I spent part of my school time and my high school time here in Odense, so it has sort of been a little drive down memory line going from the railway station and out here. And actually, I used to fly model airplanes almost where these buildings are standing in the old days. Anyway, I'm going to talk about topology optimization or geometric design optimization, going from and actually starting in mechanics and then gradually making my way into physics and photonics and stuff like that. Let me start by showing a number of pictures I found on the internet of some beautiful and intricate structures you see here. And common for these structures is that they are all manufactured using so-called additive manufacturing. So this is a new manufacturing technology, or it has also been developing through the last few decades. But the main thing is it allows to build all kinds of imaginable or unimaginable structures with high complexity. And as such, industrial designers and architects love these methods because suddenly you can build everything you can envision. And certainly also from a mechanical engineering perspective, it's interesting because suddenly you can optimize structures such that you save weight, you come up with the structures in a way that there's no surplus material, that they are the absolute optimal structures for carrying loads. And why do we want to find optimal structures, or why do we want to cut away material from structures? Well, just these numbers, I think, say it all. If you build an airplane and you can solve 1 kilo of weight on this airplane, then you, that corresponds to a fuel saving of 300 and up to 1,000 kilos of fuel per year per the kilo you saved. In cars, it's less, but nevertheless, these are impressive numbers. And so nowadays, people in the airplane industry, they try to cut away material everywhere. Even they would go to small brackets holding the overhead cabin luggages. And if they can save 10 grams on each of these brackets, well, if there's 1,000 on them on the plane, well, then you save 10 kilos, and we are talking about tons of fuel saving. So you really want to take advantage of these possibilities that advanced manufacturing methods allow. Now, if you also look at the internet here, you see that all these structures are very intricate. They are not just, they haven't come from human intuition. There is something behind it. There's something systematic optimization behind it. And if you look up the names, you will see all kinds of weird or strange or special names: bionic design, topology optimization, morphogenesis, and metamorphosis, generative design, and stuff like that. And actually, all these names are sort of, you could just call them brand names. If you dig into it, they all originate in one method that was started back in 30 years ago by Noboru Kikuchi and Martin Bensu. They were applied mathematicians. They used a lot of mathematical theories. They used knowledge of optimal microstructures that adapt to loads and stuff like that. And out of their studies back then came pictures like this. So this is a bridge structure loaded in the center, supported at the edges there. And when you look at these, they're pretty terrible structures, right? They are nothing like what we saw before. They are sort of spongy-looking structures, hard to manufacture. And so it's actually a wonder that this led to the fantastic structures we saw before. But I will actually come back to that later on. The problem was these are not easily manufacturable. So people looked for other ways to do this, skipping all of this advanced math. And essentially, people came up with other methods. And after a work I did with Bensu in 1999, these simpler methods, density methods, or level set methods, became the de facto standard for doing topology optimization. And these advanced theories were left behind. But I will come back to those later on. So just to explain shortly on an example here, I'm taking a little bracket example here. So it could be a door hinge or something like that. You have four holes where it's attached to the wall, and you have a door hanging on this that provides some loads there. And actually, this mechanical design problem was the subject of a competition sent out internationally by the US company General Electric, where they wanted to see the potential of additive manufacturing to optimize brackets. And 630 entries were evaluated, and the winner came up with a design like this, which again would be difficult to manufacture using standard methods, but could easily be 3D printed. But if there are mechanical engineers in the room here, they will see, okay, even though this was the winner out of 640, it's not a very smart design because, for example, these four parts here, they are attached to the wall, so there's really no need to have material here in between the legs. So obviously, this is not an optimal design. You need something better. You need something that is not depending on predefined geometry, something that can distribute material in an optimal way. And the idea, and that's where this topology optimization method comes into play, is we divide this, what we could call the design domain, up to a lot of small voxels, we could call them or pixels in 3D, and we want to find which of these voxels should have material and which not, in order to optimize the structure. And so we do analysis, we figure out what are the stresses inside there, where the structure is lightly loaded, you can remove material, where it's highly loaded, you add material, you start with a sponge, and gradually it grows towards either material or no material. And so just an animation of this design process, you will see, okay, it's started from the end, I think it starts over, you sort of see you start with nothing and then material grows, and you get a structure that is totally different from what actually won the competition. And by building and testing, we actually saved another 10% compared to the winner. So it was kind of sad that we hadn't discovered that this competition was going on, because we would have won it if we had been in there. So this is sort of the popular introduction. I don't want to show too many equations here, because I know people have widely different backgrounds, but just a few words, because there's a lot of mathematics behind this. But essentially, we have a design domain. Ideally, we want to determine should each of these pixels or voxels be filled with material or not. That gives us a combinatorial problem that is almost impossible to solve, or probably impossible. But instead, we then introduce an artificial, or you could call it a density design variable in each element that can go between smoothly between 0 and 1. 0 meaning no material, 1 meaning solid material. And the advantage of having a continuous variable is we can compute gradients, and we can thereby do search directions that take us towards optimal design very efficiently. And so mathematically stated, we have a vector of design variables rho, so those are the densities in each of these pixels here. We optimize some objective function, could be the compliance, the inverse of stiffness. We have volume constraints. We could have other constraints that depend either on these density variables or the state here, which here in the beginning are the displacements that are computed from analysis, but later on could be the electric field or the fluid velocity or something like that. And so these PDEs, partial differential equations, as Asker put it before, can usually be described by some kind of linear or nonlinear system that we have behind it here. So this is sort of the optimization problem. Now, I introduce these continuous variables, which means that when we start optimizing, we could end up in structures that have a lot of this gray, spongy material. If we want to get rid of that, we can do different tricks. One is to say, if we see, take the stiffness as a function of this density variable here, if we say that intermediate values have low, proportionally low stiffness here, it means that the optimizer doesn't like to use this gray material. It would prefer to use either solid or void. And in that way, even though we solve a continuous problem, we end up in a discrete solution very efficiently. So this is sort of the math behind it. Then we have a computer algorithm that essentially goes through iterations. It does this initialization where we put the boundary conditions and define the PDE. We solve the PDE, preferably using finite element analysis, but it could also be other kinds of analysis, as long as it can be done on a computer efficiently. Then a very important step is sensitivity analysis, or some of the physicists would call it perturbation analysis. And it turns out that we can compute the gradient. So that's what happens to the objective function, the stiffness of the structure, if we change each of the design variables a little bit, because from that we take our descent direction when we optimize. It turns out that this can be done extremely efficiently at using a method called adjoint analysis, which means that we have to solve just one extra problem, which is similar to the original problem. So it means that even if I have millions or a billion design variables, then I can compute these gradients very cheaply. So essentially independently on how many design variables I have. So that's sort of the strength of the method. We can compute these gradients very efficiently. Then we put in different regularization steps in there. We do the optimization and we iterate onto the convergence. So this is actually the amount of theory I'm going to serve you. And now I will more talk about results and outcomes. So the algorithm I just showed you is essentially the basis of many commercial software these days. And if you are interested, you can, of course, get into some of these commercial softwares. Or actually, we also put some popular apps on the internet. You can download it both for your iPhone or for your Android phone. And it will actually allow you to do topology optimization interactively. It will constantly optimize. You can change the load cases, move the loads and stuff like that. And you can see how this actually works real time almost. And I will just demonstrate. So this is the 3D app we have out there. And as a default, it will just optimize the structure. It's supported at the wall. It has a distributed load here. So it gives you sort of a hanger or a structure there. Now I will change this. So you will see here, I will change it to a bridge structure. I put in a bridge deck. I scale it. I add loads to the bridge deck. I change the boundary conditions. I change to symmetry conditions. And now you will see as you change stuff, the bridge grows. If you want to move the bridge deck, you move it up and the structure will adapt also. So it's kind of really, I find it very fascinating to play around with and get an idea of what are optimal structures and stuff like that. So this is sort of out there these days. You can do amazing things with that. And of course, you also want to press the boundaries for what's possible to optimize. And one obvious thing is, could we optimize a full airplane wing structure? Of course, if you look at this, so this is the cutout of a modern Boeing 787 passenger plane. And if you look at this, this is the wing structure. You will see actually it consists of spars and it consists of very regularly placed ribs here. So this is sort of the standard in airplane design. And if you go more than 100 years back, you will actually see that the Wright brothers also did the same. They had spars and they had ribs. And that sort of seems to be how airplane wings are done. But the question is, should they actually look so like that if you freely optimize? So we wanted to do that. And essentially, we were stuck sort of in what I call the Duplo syndrome, because topology optimization was at the stage of Duplo for just a few years ago, I would say. So the thing is, as a child, you can do fantastic, amazing things with Duplo bricks here. But at some point, and you can imagine that this is an airplane, but at some point, you sort of see, OK, this doesn't really give us a good airplane structure. We want to shift to this fine resolution, real Lego bricks to build a real airplane. And similarly, topology optimization was limited to fairly coarse resolution so far. And we had to push it towards the real Lego bricks. And so if we look at an airplane, so now we are taking the Boeing 777 airplane. The reason is that there exist public experimental results for the loads for different velocities and angles of attack and stuff, and all the geometries are given. So we said, okay, let's take the Boeing 777 wing structure and try to topology optimize it. And the first thing is we have to mesh it. So we have to put it into these voxels that I was talking about. And with state-of-the-art topology optimization, we could use like 5 million voxels. And if you have a regular mesh like this here, you would see that the innermost elements, they would have a physical size of something like 5 by 5 by 5 centimeters. Note here that it's really big, this wing, right? It's 28 meters here. It's 12 meters here. The profile is 2 meters high. So even with 5 million elements, it's really built by Duplo bricks if you have this resolution. So to go to real Lego bricks of fine scale resolution that actually can resolve the level of detail that should be in a real airplane, well, we needed to go below 1 centimeter cube, which means we needed this number of elements, which essentially is more than 1 billion elements. And that's what I call gigavoxel resolution. And so this was not simple. We had to do advanced parallel computing. We had to develop iterative solvers. And we had to get access to supercomputers that actually could solve problems like this. We got that from the PRACE project, the European Supercomputing Network, and could run it on in France. And the outcome of that study was the following here. So the only thing we prescribed was the load cases governing standard flight and a thin outer shell. And the rest of this came out of this iterative topology optimization process. And we sort of cut off the top part of the wing, and you see a quite intricate internal structure here. And if we look at it, we see sort of also these bars that we saw before in front of and the back. So that seems to be right to have sort of a wing box. But then when we zoom in, we see all kinds of fantastic detail. It looks almost like a bird wing or something like that, where you support the flap regions and you see various truss structures and stuff. And if you zoom in here, we see this very intricate curved ribs here. This is not the screen resolution, but the small stripes here correspond to the elements, so the Lego bricks that the structure was discretized with. And essentially, I think it sort of shows amazing structural detail, and we were happy to get that published in Nature 2 years ago. A few more words on that. I told that there are multiple load cases, so the structure I just showed you was this one here, seen from above. But it is typically very important to optimize for several load cases. So if we look at the first structure here, this was just optimized for neutral flight. And what we see here, whereas we had these two spars that sort of generate a wing box, then here there's only one spar, which means it's very stiff just for bending. But if you started having a higher angle of attack, it would have a huge torsion and it would be bad. Likewise, this one was optimized for a higher angle of attack. It has a wing box out here, but none here. So again, this alone would not be a good structure. But if you combine several load cases, you get these kinds of structures that are good for any load case. And actually, the last one here is also where we mimic a load from the engine power here. And then you get extra material here to transfer the loads to the structure here. So then you can ask, okay, nice pictures. Will probably take a while before it's actually built, but what can you gain by this? And so that was also a demand by Nature before we could get it published, was how much do you exactly gain by this? And obviously, we are not in a position to tell that. It will still take thousands of man-years of working time to actually take these geometries and put them into a real airplane. I'm sure it will happen someday, but right now we cannot do it. But we sort of found two things that were important. Partly, we have these curved wing spars, and partly we have curved ribs. And so we tried quantitatively to evaluate that. And so the first thing is, if we look, this is a cut through the wing profile. And what we see, these bars here in a standard airplane, they would just be straight here, but they are curved like this. And the secret is here, if it was just bending, then the straight spars would be optimal. But since there's also torsion, then a circular rod is optimal. So the optimizer is trying to do sort of the optimal compromise between bending stiffness and torsional stiffness. And you can sort of evaluate that by having a square box or a rounded box. And you will see that the torsional stiffness increases quite rapidly with just small roundings of these spars, whereas the bending stiffness just decreases slightly. So it's much better to do these rounded caps. And we evaluated that maybe 4 or 5% gain by having these curved spars. The other thing was these ribs. In standard airplanes, you would have these straight ribs. Here, the optimizer told us to make curved ribs. And we evaluated a saving of approximately 1%. So I'm talking about 4% here, which doesn't sound much. But again, using the numbers I showed you earlier, we estimated something like 20 to 400 tons of savings of this. So that's definitely important numbers. Now, let me go on. So you have seen these structures that look actually quite natural. I said it will take a while before a full airplane structure is optimized. But actually, the Airbus are doing experiments on these for flaps, where they also get these nice natural-looking structures. And some people, biologists like Don is somewhere here also, might think, okay, this, I have seen that in Nature. And actually, you can find, so this is the water lily structure. When you look at that, it looks almost exactly like that. So there is some inspiration and some similar goals here. It's always a little bit dangerous to make this one-to-one analysis because we have to imagine that this is a dead structure. This is a live structure. So it's not only optimizing stiffness for this water lily, but there's also something with transporting nutrition. So you cannot just take nature structures or nature appearing structures and make them into airplane and then expect that they will be optimal airplanes. So we need the optimization still. Okay, so where does it take us? Well, right now we are expanding this to ultra large scale bridge design. You all know the Great Belt Bridge. Essentially, it's built on old technology that has existed since the 1950s. So the bridge deck there is made as a sort of a standard section, a bridge girder it's called. And again, it has some spars and some straight ribs there. And they have sort of gotten to the edge of what can be saved. And therefore, they cannot make longer bridges. So again, we have a project together with Kovi and an industrial PhD student. This is some of the initial designs here. It looks like total chaos here, but it's actually quite optimized. And if you look at it from above, I think it's clear again that it's telling us some story. It wants to have some curved ribs. We are still working on this one. The bridge deck is much bigger than the airplane wing, so we are aiming at 20 billion elements. This is so far only 650 million elements. So that's still developing. Now, I guess that's a nice story to say and tell. So we can do large structures, but there's one little caveat here. And I didn't mention that. I said it was a supercomputer it was run on. The thing I have to admit is it took to run the airplane wing structure from before 1 million CPU hours. So that's 8,000 processors for 6 days or a single processor for a lifetime of a human. So that's quite expensive, and even the bigger manufacturing departments cannot afford that. They want quick answers. They want quick suggestions for the designs. And so this is what we are aiming at these days. And so what our goal, and also partly with the Willum Investigator project, is to bring what you have seen so far to real time, which is an ambitious goal. That's what the foundation asks for. But essentially, we want to do futures aircraft design by something like our interactive app. So the goal is to make an interactive app where you can sit and work on it, and the structure will appear as you have seen it. So this requires 4 to 5 orders of speed up in computational time, which definitely is not going to happen with just patience waiting for Moore's law to develop. We have to do something smarter there. And I'll just sort of briefly sketch what we are aiming at. And actually, we go back to the past and look at the Bensei-Kikuchi results again and actually think, these pictures, they look terrible, right? Nothing manufacturable. But actually, they used a lot of interesting theory. They had knowledge of optimal microstructures. And that's why these pictures look like that. So in reality, at every point here, there is an optimal microstructure hidden in there. It's just a matter of extracting this information out of these pictures and then producing the results. And since this can be done on a very coarse mesh and still have a very fine resolution, we should be able to save a lot of time. And so I will just sort of go through it briefly. This would be a Bensei-Kikuchi design. Looks terrible. But if we enlarge here, you will see a microstructure that's oriented along the principal stress directions, and the grayscale determines something of the dimensions there. And in reality, at every point here, there exists an optimal microstructure, and we just have to extract it. If we sort of just do it the naive way, we put one of these rectangular boxes everywhere, we get a structure looking like that. Again, you can sort of see that it's loaded here, supported at the left end. You can sort of see that the structure goes towards the stress directions and stuff. But if you look at it with a microscope, this is definitely not an optimal structure. This will deform badly, right? So we need to do something smarter than that. And essentially, again, to put it short, we start with this Bensei-Kikuchi result on a very coarse mesh. Then we extract the information, so the angles of the principal stress directions, using a least square problem. These fields, the gradient of these fields, are oriented along the optimal material directions. Then we take the cosines of these fields. We get this here. We put those together, put in information about the optimal microstructure, and we project it to a fine scale. And voila, with a saving of like a factor of 50 just in a simple MATLAB implementation, we can get from very coarse, efficient analysis from the Bensu-Kikuchi result to a fine scale solution. And so this is sort of a combination of prior insight, modern computer graphics methods, and extra physics that we can do this. Just to show, so actually it turns out that we could prove that this structure is optimal, and hence when we project it to a scale, we can evaluate, this would be the figure of merit, and actually we can control these length scales, and we will see that the figure of merit or the stiffness of this structure is not significantly deteriorated when we do these mappings. So it's actually still producing something close to optimal structures. And just a picture extra, this is a beautiful, this was actually already envisioned by Michel 100 years ago as the optimal solution. I just show it because it looks so nice. What you also see, if some of you are in additive manufacturing, is that we are sort of approaching an infill structure, as it's called in additive manufacturing. If you again look at the internet, it has sort of been quite become quite popular to do a topology optimization and then put in a lattice structure afterwards. And people love it because it looks fantastic and optimal and beautiful and stuff like that. The sad thing is, this is by no means optimal. Turns out that open-walled lattice structures, they only have half the stiffness of closed-walled structures. So actually, it's pretty, from a stiffness perspective, pretty stupid to do like this. Of course, it looks good. The real optimal structure is closed-walled, which means that it would sort of be a porous but closed cell structure. You wouldn't be able to see the microstructure from outside, and then people would be bored by looking at the additive manufacturing part because you don't see that it's optimal. So there is an advantage is that you sort of spread out the structure such that it might be better in stability. It would not buckle, become unstable, but that's still something we are investigating. Anyway, just with our projection method, we can sort of show, I'll just do it shortly, here's a structure that is supported at both ends, loaded in the center. If we do it as a solid structure, we get this one. If we say we optimize it using a porous infill structure that's isotropic, we get this one, which is much worse in, so this is the compliance. The compliance is much higher than the original structure. But if we allow anisotropic infill, so infill that's oriented along the principal stress directions, we get a much better stiffness. And if we also allow the stiffness in two directions to be different, we again get a much better stiffness. So the morale here, or the take-home message, is if you see additively manufactured structures with isotropic infill like triangular regions, run away, they are not good. But if you see something that sort of adapts to the stress lines and stuff, it's much better. Okay, and then just a little sort of side story. When you have students or co-workers that move to other departments, it's Jun Wu, he moved to a design engineering department in Delft after working with me. Then he puts his students to work on these techniques. So this is a chair they mimicked. They come up with these fantastic and beautiful structures again. This time you see that the material adapts to the loading directions. And they actually also build it and put students on the chairs here. It doesn't say anything about how comfortable it is, but at least I think it's a very beautiful chair here. Okay. So what's next? Well, we are also, meanwhile, we are working on the 3D projection part, just showing some initial results. And again, I said we had like two orders of magnitude time reduction in 2D, but we are approaching three orders in 3D these days, and sort of we are slowly approaching what I promised to the Willem Foundation. Okay, so now, we are okay in time. You have seen mechanics. As Asker said before, whenever we can model something with a PDE, a partial differential equation, which is the case for all kinds of systems in fluids, in acoustics, in thermal problems, optics, photonics, and stuff like that, well, then we could apply this method, at least if the placement of material is important. So in the remainder of this talk, I will just go into a few other physics problems that I hope will be of interest to some of you. And I will start with the thermal problems and again show some pictures from the internet about what people have been looking at, both biologists and mathematicians and stuff. It's the so-called volume-to-point problem or area-to-point problem. So it's you could see it as this long here. You have a point here. You are collecting something from here, from the lungs, and you want to, as efficiently as possible, to conduct this to this point here. And it could be roots here also. You want to collect fluid from everywhere. How do you do that as efficiently as possible? And there's actually a theory developed by the French applied mathematician Adrien Bichang. You might have heard about it, which is called constructal theory, where he says that these structures can be built as a hierarchy of structures that keep sort of in a fractal way covering the whole space. Beautiful theory, looks fantastic. Unfortunately, it's wrong. Trees are not optimal, at least for the simple problem with the thermal conduction if you have a distributed heat source and want to get it out at one point here. So we looked at this problem. It has also been a model problem for topology optimization for quite a while, but we used this new projection approach that I spoke about with the knowledge of optimal microstructures. So this picture actually has a laminate of structures here. It can be proven to be optimal. If we do our projection approach, it says that it should not be a tree, but like pins. And if we take these projections as starting guess and do some subsequent optimization with different imposed length scales, then we will actually, we get all these pictures. In some cases, we get trees, but they are suboptimal. It turns out these three with the red boxes are the optimal structures. And so actually, heat trees are not optimal, pins are. And again, there might be other reasons for trees, because they also have to grow from one end. If you have a branch and it comes to a point, then it's better to split it. But if you can put the branch at once, it's better to have a pin. So there are differences between optimization, getting the actual optimal structures, and biological structures, again here. A more advanced case of thermodynamics is this one here. So this is a project we had with a Danish startup company called AT Lighting. They were providing cooling, passive cooling fins for LED lamps. So essentially, I don't think we have LED lamps here, but often they actually, even though they're very efficient, they produce heat. If they get too hot, the lifetime of them will be decreased. So you want to cool them. You could put an active ventilator on it, but in a concert hall, you don't want the noise. So you would like to have some passive cooling fins that, in an optimal way, lead the heat away from the LED lamp. And the industrial designer behind this company, he had come up with this structure, which obviously looks very nice also from a design perspective. But we said we can do better with topology optimization. And so now you have to do Navier-Stokes equations behind it. You have to have a big domain around it to not have boundary effects and stuff like that. And again, it requires supercomputing. I had some very nice animations that somehow with my update of the computer didn't work today. I saw it in the train, so I just put in stills to save it. But essentially, these pictures show visualizations of three optimized heat fins for LED lamps. And again, it depends on how they're used. So in this case here, if it's just put so the LED lamp is on this side here, and this is the structure, if you can count that it only has one position, then it will make some vertical walls that by passive convection, so they're hot, they will accelerate the fluid and in that way cool it very efficiently. If you want it to be less sensitive to the orientation of the device, you could impose extra symmetries, get something like this. And if you can trust that it's always sitting in a vertical position, you get something like that, that has a lot of vertical wall, but also sort of sucks in the fluid and puts it through as a chimney effect. So these are very intricate structures, partly tree-like, because it's a much more complex problem than before. I'm sure some of you will think it's like a coral, which has essentially the same effect here. They look nice, I think. For me, all optimal structures look nice. But you, of course, also want to test them and look at them. This just shows the flow patterns here. This was the designer's best structure. You see it's quite inefficient because heat being coming out of the lower parts will heat the upper parts. But here, the optimized structures sort of prevent these effects. So definitely, the optimization is telling us something. We did experiments. So we built them using 3D printing, metal printing, used infrared cameras and velocity measurements, and saw that they indeed are better. So this was the designer's best, was the blue one. This was a simplified version, and this is our, where we have temperature difference and power. So this was experimentally verified. One issue here is actually that 3D printing of metal parts is still very expensive. So this company would not survive by selling these things 3D printed. But then we tested also so-called investment casting process, where you 3D print a structure in a vax, and then you make a negative of that, pour in Britannica metal. So it's like tin soldiers that some of you might have built in or made in your youth. And we get structures that are almost as efficient. A little interesting thing on the side is that the guys who actually manufactured these structures did some casting simulations before doing it. And usually you have to be very careful when you do cast parts because the cooling has to be sort of happen in a very special manner such that you don't get internal voids. But they said they had never seen as optimal and structure regarding casting as this one. And obviously this is not strange because it was already optimized for optimal heat conduction behavior. And so it turns out that optimal for cooling is also at least close to optimal for casting. So I think that was a nice byproduct. So this was fluids. Then, as promised, getting down to nanophotonics stuff. And here I stole a picture from Asker's group telling about the marvels of light-matter interaction. So I don't have to define why this is interesting. But the thing is, so you have optical systems. If you go and build structures down at the wavelength of the light, then you can get advanced light-matter interaction and get all kinds of interesting behaviors. And so you can get guiding of light around corners. Some, again, natural systems like the morpho butterfly, they have nanostructured shields on the wings, which gives it this iridescent color scheme. And they can be used for all kinds of laser and on chips and plasmons, super radiance, and all kinds of interesting things. And again, we see here, these systems can be modeled by PDEs, this time Maxwell's equations. And we see that the topology or the material distribution is important. And then we get into business again. Right? So I'm just going to show you one case of nano-optics and then a very weird application towards the very end. So the specific application we are looking at is now a photonic cavity. And so essentially this is a so-called photonic crystal. It has, and so the length scale here is approximately the size of the wavelengths of light. So we are down in some 100 nanometers here. And it has been known for a while that if you make a periodic structure here, you can create so-called band gaps where light cannot propagate. And if you then make a defect here, then essentially light cannot propagate around it. So light would be confined here. And this is what is called a photonic cavity. And what people want to do is they put some active material in there. So that could be some kind of quantum dot or quantum well. And if you then excite it here, if the field is strong enough, the chances of spontaneous emission will be increased. And hence, you can build up a lasing cavity here that then can be used for some kind of photonic integrated circuit here. Now, again, you want to optimize that. And so we did that. First, I just want to show the reference design. That's just this ideal photonic crystal with one defect in the center. Our goal here is to maximize the Purcell factor, or something you could say, the quality factor divided by the mode volume. So you want to confine light as much as possible. Yellow is a strong enhancement. This does something, but not so well, right? You could then start sort of by naive optimization, just changing the radius and the position of the innermost holes. You could get something that just by the looks is more efficient, doubles this value merit. And then you could put topology optimization into the game again and see what happens. And you get a marvelous looking structure like this one here. And you see definitely that the light is extremely confined here. It also has some funny hairs and stuff. But actually, so it has this bow tie structure, which actually some other physicists have seen before us, but then it's surrounded by these funny hairy structures here. And I'm sure Asker, he gets a little bit nervous when he hears that we use standard Maxwell's equations to model something that actually has extremely small details there. You probably need some kind of non-local model there. Also, it will be extremely difficult to manufacture such things that are down to a few nanometers in size. So with our different tools, we can introduce a length scale that prevents such small details. Then we get a structure looking like that. And let's see, okay, we went three orders of magnitude up here, then we lost a couple of orders of magnitude in performance here. But this is an easily manufacturable design where smallest detail is controlled to something like 65 nanometers. So obviously, depending on your talents in the manufacturing lab, your real structure might be somewhere in between. And the better you are at manufacturing, the better quality factor you can get. So I think that's sort of a nice little study. Also, the footprint of this is very important. So we can study what happens if we make a smaller and smaller device. How does the topology change here? Obviously, the performance gets worse, but it's still optimized. And then interestingly, I think also what is commonly the thing that the optimizer tries to tell us a story. It tries to tell us something, right? It's not random. You see that from these structures, right? It has this little spooky guy in the middle, and it has these circular rings around it. So the optimizer is trying to tell us that there is some general thing to be learned here, and sort of a very simple interpretation of that would be that the close to optimal structure would be something like that. So I think that's the real beauty when we can take the outcome of topology optimization and extract knowledge that gives us some simplified designs. Right? Maybe I will skip that. This just shows this was a reference design as a performance as a function of the size. This extracted topology is here. If we optimize it, we are here. So that's these structures. And if we have better control of the length scales, we could move up here. So it's just a matter of collaborating with the experimental guy in order to figure out what structure can be and what performance can be achieved. So that was the nanophotonics. And then the furthest away from mechanical engineering, I would say, is now venturing into topological insulators. And I think at least the physicists here know it very well. Actually, the Nobel Prize was given for topological insulators in 2016. These are very hot topics in solid-state physics. And actually, in sort of nanoscale, both in acoustics and photonics, they have also been become popular. And probably there, they can be used sort of as a model thing where you can actually do experiments. And therefore, they are also very popular. So this specific paper said we have an acoustic topological isolator. And the thing is, it gets complicated to explain, but essentially you would have two states or two materials where waves cannot propagate. But if you design them appropriately and put them together, there will be a topologically insulated mode walking on the boundary between the two. And such topologically insulated states there are predicted to be insensitive to variations in the structure, and you can have one-way wave propagation and fantastic stuff like that. There are different ways to do this. You can do it by introducing destroying or breaking time reversal symmetry. So some people put in a fluid that actually circulates, and in that way you break time reversal symmetry and you can get these special behaviors. We will not break time reversal symmetry here, so it's just purely dielectrics. And what we live from is so-called quantum spin Hall edge states. And it's complicated, and it requires quite some intuition to come up with these structures. What seems to be sort of the general idea is that you look for some periodic structure that has a double Dirac cone. Then you perturb this structure and hope that this perturbation generates two band gaps of one and the other material. Then you take those two materials, put them together, and cross fingers that there will be an edge state running between them. And so this is cumbersome, and we are thinking, we do topology optimization, couldn't we do topology optimization of topological insulators, with the topology having two different meanings in this sense here. And again, to make a long story short, we sort of got inspired by other things. So we are assuming we have two periodic materials, one black one, one yellow one. We want to send in light here, and we want to have this special behavior of the light that it can only propagate if it has the orange material on the right-hand side. So it means that it can propagate along here, it can propagate along here because it remains the orange material on the right-hand side, and it can also propagate here because propagating here will also have the orange material on the right-hand side. Whereas here, it will have the orange material on the left-hand side, so it shouldn't propagate. But we want to do it without this band engineering first. We just specify input here, maximize output here and there, minimize output here. It's a little bit more to it because we also have to introduce, there has to be a band gap in these bulk regions, but that's about it. We start the optimization and we see what happens. And essentially our starting guess, so this is the structure here, that's just a simple periodic structure. It has a band gap. You see that here, we are exciting it here. There's a band gap in the frequency response. We excite it here. You see that the waves do not really propagate here. That's our starting guess. Then we maximize here and there, minimize here, and minimize the fields inside the subregions, see what happens. And out comes these two regions. So it found these by itself. We just started with this. You will see that the light is now nicely confined here. Obviously, we don't know what is the effect. It's not necessarily a topological insulator. It could be some other edge mode or something like that. But interestingly, when we look at the band diagram afterwards, we actually see these pseudo-spin modes here, one indicating a right polarized or right rotating and another the left rotating structure. So it comes out of this, what we could call a top-down optimization approach, without having to carefully engineer the band structure. So I think that's kind of cute. This was for acoustics. We have just submitted a paper for the photonics example. So far, we kept symmetries, C6V symmetry on these structures. If we relax these symmetries, it seems like even more interesting stuff is coming out with some previously unseen states that we will publish in the future. And so with these funny materials here, we can sort of study it. If we send in a wave from the left, you will see that the mode is confined to the edge here. And those of you in the front rows can actually see that these modes are sort of rotating ones. Then there's this thing of directional propagation. If we just put a standard point source here, actually the field would propagate in both directions. But if we put in a chiral source that essentially is introducing a mode that is rotating, then we will see this kind of one-way mode propagation because it can only, this spin state can only propagate in one direction. And lastly here, we put in defects. So essentially we made a division here and we see that the edge modes just follow the interface between the two without any significant loss. So I think it sort of confirms that we are on the right way here. So that's sort of the tour de force through optimization of structures by topology optimization. I think I have convinced you or confirmed what Asker said, that any PDE can be subjected to topology optimization. You can get interesting stuff. our main work is actually right now on getting from this gigavoxel resolution down to something that can be modeled by multi-scale approaches. So if you are interested, there's more info on our webpage, and I list sort of some of the relevant recent papers also for your info. And definitely, if you like what you saw, you could also download the apps and have a play with it yourself. So thank you very much for your attention.